So I promise that I'll stop talking about cameras in the next vlog. But for this vlog...
toy you get as a kid. I've just been dunking it in water and dunking it in water. The cleanup though.
Anyway, so a very quick review of the DJI Osmo Action camera that I recently purchased. It's pretty much everything I expected it to be. It's got a really nice wide angle shot. Even with both the rock steady stabilization turned on and the D-warp functionality turned on, which crops in the picture a bit, it's still incredibly wide and it performs very, very well in good light. In fact, it's got some really nice dynamic range in there. I don't know, some kind of new 2019 technology, unlike the 2014 of this camera. And it's also, as you can see, waterproof, and that's really one of the most fun things I've ever experienced in a camera. Ever, perhaps. But also, of course, it's got its downsides, which is also expected. For example, the low light performance is rather poor, which means that it's going to be very difficult to use this in this room at all, because the lighting in this room is horrible. I did buy a new light. See that? Yeah. It's helping, for sure, but the lighting in this room is still pretty trash, so maybe I can set this up very quickly just to show you how this would perform in a relatively poorly lit room like this one. It's kind of daylight right now, so it's actually better than usual already, but yeah. So anyway, switching over to this camera in 3, 2, 1. And as you can see, it's remarkably darker. I have not changed any of the lights in here at all. I have set the ISO to 200, which is kind of a safe value where you will not have too much noise, and the result of that is the whole room appears quite a bit darker. Now I can set this to ISO 400, which will introduce some noticeable noise, but will make the picture look perhaps quite a bit better. So actually let's try that as well. Let me just... There we go, it's now ISO 400, and what should happen is that there should be a bit more noticeable noise, which I can't really tell from the preview, of course, but from my testing. Also granted, I tested it at night, so currently with daylight, maybe it would actually look okay with ISO 400. This is actually going to be interesting information for me as well when I actually edit this. So if this looks good, then that's going to be great. That's going to mean that I can actually use this in my room in daylight. But we'll see. I suppose another cool thing about this camera as well is that because it's so small, I'm actually just holding it right now, and it's got the rock steady image stabilization, which is really good. I don't always need to have this mounted on a tripod or on something that's solid. I can actually just hold it and talk into it like you're seeing right now, which means that I can, you know, overcome the low light shortcomings a bit by just plastering myself against the window so that you can actually see me being lit by natural light, which should look pretty good, although I can't tell that well with the preview. So one of the selling points of this camera is that it's got a front screen and I can actually see myself right now, just not very clearly because it's a very small screen, but still, the front screen is great. And you know, it really shows you what you're shooting and lets you aim around a bit, although the wideness of it already makes it very easy. Oh, look how wide that is. I love how wide that is. Anyway, I've probably wasted too much time on that by now. It's 2 p.m. and I gotta head out for lunch, and I think I'm just gonna leave this camera here and just bring this camera down and see if I can, you know, just try to shoot some random stuff and put it through its paces a bit and see what I can do with it. I nearly dropped it. There's still some nice blue sky over there, but over there, it's pretty much about to rain. It's been raining pretty much every day these days. Well, speak of the devil. A very quick bit that I also noticed about this camera is that the back LCD screen, it's actually pretty nice and large, and I like how it feels on the touch, but it's surprisingly hard to see in daylight. And especially the viewing angles is pretty poor, so if you have it like on the ground trying to shoot some kind of B-roll, I virtually could not see what was on the screen at all, so I couldn't aim it, I couldn't like kind of frame my shot. So probably some of the, especially on the ground B-rolls, are gonna look a little bit wonky. So, small issue there. It also kind of heats up a bit, but granted, we live in pretty hostile, sweltering weather here in Singapore. So it would probably be an issue if you use this as like your sole camera and you're constantly shooting on it, it may overheat or something. But for me, using it as a kind of supplementary camera, I don't think it's going to be an issue. So. And now to actually get some work done, enough fooling around for a while. I have quite a bit to get done today, so let's get to it. Housemate's latest online shopping item. Not sure what it is, but I almost dropped it. I'll leave this outside his door. It's 6:30 p.m., almost time for dinner, so I'm gonna just take a short break here. And I figure that I'll also, you know, just take the chance to talk about the essay that I read on camera a few days ago. case any of you saw that, and in case any of you may be wondering what that essay is about, what it means, and all that sort of things. So, it's an essay titled Hedonics. It's written by C.S. Lewis, one of my favorite authors of all time. And the basic idea behind the essay is that there are these occasions, these moments in our lives where we get, you know, seemingly, you could say, unreasonable occasions for happiness or joy. And then the example that he gives in his essay is him riding the train through the suburbs of London, and he was talking about these houses that are so unfamiliar to him, and at that moment it just seemed to bring him like an unspeakable sort of joy. Those houses, none of them are anything special, the people in them are not special. But he comes back and he says that that's no reason why we could not indulge in the moment of happiness as it comes to you, right? And I think that's something that I can relate with as well, because, you know, in my own example, it could be something like me walking out the door, the front door, and I just look at the sky and suddenly realize that, oh, what, the sky is so blue today. So C.S. Lewis talks about this impulse within us that seems to attempt to resist this sort of moments for unexpected joy. And this impulse, which he calls the jailer, would try to rationalize, semi-rationalize it in a way that makes it silly, makes it seem silly for us to be enjoying the occasion. So for example, you may try to say that, why are you so concerned about the sky being blue? It's been blue many times before in the past. You're just being stupidly happy over nothing. You should be thinking about, you know, your job, your responsibilities, whatever it is that you need to do. This sort of half-rationalizations that attempt to deflect these occasions for joy and happiness that inadvertently comes to us. And C.S. Lewis' thesis basically says we should tell this jailer to GTFO, for lack of a better word for it. Because just because the sky is blue yesterday as well as today doesn't mean that today, when something inside of me somehow aligns enough with it to make me notice it, to make me feel a sense of happiness in having noticed it, there's no reason for me to reject that occasion for happiness and joy just because the sky is no different today than it was yesterday. The difference is I didn't notice it yesterday, but if I notice it today, then that's okay, that's perfectly good reason for me to be happy. The whole idea is that we should not let the half-rationalizations of this inner jailer take away these occasions for happiness. And I suppose the corollary as well, which I deeply believe, is that there are no shortage of occasions for joy and happiness in the world. The world is very rich and very beautiful, but we are not always able to align with it and enjoy it, and that's the problem. And I don't want to say that this is the fault of us. Like, if you're miserable, if someone's miserable, I don't think it's necessarily his fault in a sense. It's a hard thing to always be able to recognize beauty as it passes us by. I think, you know, the fact is that we let lots of occasions for nourishment, for admiration passes by because we're just not built to naturally notice these things, and it only comes to us some of the time. The point is that it's not the problem in the world. People who think that the world is fundamentally an ugly place, I think, are fundamentally mistaken. The world is incredible, but it's very difficult for us to be able to see it. And one of the things we can do to help us see the actual beauty, the actual wonderfulness of the world, is for us to be able to silence this inner jailer. When we are able to strike a chord, when we are able to seize some particular speck of beauty, no matter how strange or adulterous it may seem, we should seize it, and we should enjoy it. And that's basically the idea behind the essay, I suppose. So, I actually actually spent a little bit of last night editing some of the B-roll footage of the DJI Osmo action camera that I shot yesterday, because I was just kind of excited that maybe I could help myself, so I just edited a little bit of it, and I think it's looking pretty good. This might be, I think, one of the best B-roll sequences that I've ever done. Although that's not saying much, because I'm not particularly good at this thing anyway, but still. You know what's kind of funny is that when I first thought to myself some time ago now that I wanted to start trying to make videos that are actually good, or at least as good as I could make them, I never had in mind this sort of stuff, this sort of fancy B-roll thingy. I never really even had a conception of them before. I was almost exclusively thinking about hiking videos, outdoor nature shots, and my primary inspiration was, of course, adventure archives. And what's interesting is that probably if the pandemic, if COVID-19 didn't happen, I probably would never have come this way, because I would just be bringing this camera along with me to hike the mountains of Japan, and I'll be trying my best to make these nature-based hiking videos instead of being stuck here in this room in Clementi and then being exposed by YouTube to the likes of Peter McKinnon and Maddie Hapoya, and getting influenced, I guess, discovering this thing. These guys are, of course, product videographers, among other things. And so watching their stuff and like slowly getting interested in it, you know, and then eventually I just started trying to do some of it on my own. And I gotta say, it's kind of fun. I don't think I'm any good at it yet. I don't have close to the right sort of equipment to do it. But in my own way, I think, you know, this B-roll is, I'm just pretty happy about it, what can I say? So it is my birthday month. On your birthday month, there are these restaurants and stuff that actually offer you birthday month deals, and they're actually pretty good. So I'm off to go take advantage of one right now. Okay, so very quick review of Roku at Bugis Plus. It was delicious. The buffet pricing can seem kind of affordable, but the drink pricing is actually kind of prohibitive. So if you're looking to come here, get like a decent amount of drinks, order drinks liberally like we did, then the cost may stack up
But it was still a good deal for us because of the birthday month deal where I actually got my portion of the buffet for free. So overall, it was a decent deal. It tasted really good. But I'm not sure if it's the place I'll come to without a discount.
So the price, obviously, clementi means because it's cheaper there.
Yes.
Variety, clementi also means because there's more stuff there.
Yeah, so that's two up for clementi, right, I guess.
But the ambience here is better.
The ambience here is better.
The smell here is better.
Less smoky, yes.
Less smoky. And the taste here is better.
Taste here is a little bit better. So, oh yeah, so that's what, 3 to 2?
That's 3 to 2.
3 to 2.
On a very arbitrary scale.
On a very arbitrary scale, yes. No, these actually feel really nice.
They are. I have one.
Kinokuniya used to be like my favorite place. You can still smell it. That's the Kinokuniya smell.
That is going to wrap up this vlog. I've got quite a bit of work to catch up on. And I'll catch up with you the next time I make a vlog, I suppose. So. Oh, also, that Sungai Buloh hiking video, it's out. Go take a look. Not sure which side, but yeah, I'll link it. Take a look if that's something you're interested in. Like and subscribe if that's something that you feel comfortable with. Yeah, check it out. Anyway, see you next time.